us to the virtual world so we can make it more like a real world and the one that we wanted it to be. So there's a relation between a force acting on a bot mechanism and the acceleration they produce. So you can guess what it is. Yes, it's dynamics. More basically, we can say the study of vector calculus somehow. So
yeah, Vivek, sorry to interrupt. Can you be a bit more louder?
Okay. Wait a second. I started from
no. Vivek, probably decrease the volume. What happens is your ambient sound gets increased. So just keep the volume less, but you talk loudly. Yeah, you speak up.
So a relationship between the force acting on a bot mechanism and the acceleration they produce. That is that what you can guess that is dynamics, and basically you can say somehow that is the study of vector calculus. You know, you have the parameters, physical forces like buoyancy, frictions, and also the damping act on the real world. You can add all that in the pi-bullet virtual world. The pi-bullet have an inbuilt function for that. That's the get dynamic info and change dynamics. You can get information about mass, center of mass, friction, and other properties of base and links. Here I've added a doc link for that. You can refer the pi-bullet doc original document for their parameters and outputs. Further on the slide, we will see it. So here's a get dynamic info. It's require your body unique ID, which you give to your bot. Next, it's link index, which is -1 default, which is default -1 for the base. And then you give the physics client ID. If in case you have connected to the multiple server, you can pick any one. So, and that's the change dynamics. The body unique ID is same, and the link index also. It was two is you can give. You can change the your UIDF files also. If you have not specified the mass, you can add mass. You can change the mass in this way. Mass, lateral friction, restitution. Here, restitution is the coefficient of the restitution. Is basically it can be the plastic collision, elastic collision, and somewhere between that. Then the next is rolling friction, spinning friction, and contact depth. Yeah, so you pretty much know about what dynamics is and what is the pi-bullet. Now we get into the code. Here is the code. I simulate in the VS code so you can get a good guess of it. Here is the same code that I wrote on that I have given on the PPT. You can visible it. So here I've added important files connected to the pi-bullet API and get to the address of the pi-bullet data. Here I load a plane URDF, that is a simple plane, and a sphere URDF, that is your simply a ball, and which I give a position at the height. At a height of 5 meters. So basically what we are doing is we are trying to bouncing the ball onto the surface that is a plane. For now I am not using the dynamics, and we see what's up. I also had a gravity of -9.8. Here you see that the ball stuck at the ground after falling. It's not bouncing back and back. we want it to bounce in. So just uncomment this. Here in change dynamics, I have given the unique body ID, that is sphere ID, which I'm referring it here. The minus one link for the base link. Stated lateral function zero. Restitution one, meaning coefficient of restitution is one, means it is elastic collision. And linear damping will be zero, means there will be no loss of energy in case, in many cases like heat energy, friction energy, or in deform. So that should not happen here. It will be the like idle condition that we study. So I just add it on the sphere ID and let's run it. See if it works or not. Run it again. You see that still the ball doesn't bounce on the plane, even though I added restitution one and frictions and damping to the zero. This is because the ball is in contact with the plane ID, means our plane surface, and only changing the parameters of the sphere will not work it. You have to change it with the body that is coming in contact with it in the case of collision and bouncing that we are doing. So here I uncomment it. I had the same parameters here, but just given the ID of plane ID, that is a plane surface. So minus one for the base link. Lateral friction zero. Lateral friction here means the coefficient of the friction, that is you call mu. That restitution one means elastic collision. Linear damping zero. There will be no loss of energy while bouncing. So save it and run it again. Now you see the ball is bouncing back and back and back. That is what we are trying to do. And furthermore, here you see these coordinates and numbers are publishing. This is because of this get info, which I used to get info of get dynamics info, given the ID of sphere and the baseline one. What this return is actually, I'm showing you by the docs. Yeah, get dynamic info. I have explained you this, what the parameters is required. And what is given is mass of the body, lateral friction, local inertial diagonal, lateral inertial position, local inertial orientation, restitution, rolling friction, spinning friction, contact damping, contact stiffness, body type, and collision margin, which you can further explore on your interest basis. Let's move to the PPT. That's the same code before applying the dynamic parts. That's the ball stick to the ground. And here it is after changing these parameters, these physical parameters which we want in our virtual world to make it act like a real world of the world that way we want. So hope you like. So that's the end of it. Hope you like it. And further, the netic will Hertz will continue. So please. Over to you, Hertz.
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, you are.
I'll just start. Yeah, is my screen visible? Everything okay?
Yes.
One sec, I'm starting. Yeah, so I'm Harsh Meshka. I will be your trainer for this session. This session is about robot control, and this is probably last session in which you will be learning something in the camp. The next session would be about things you can do in the pipeline. Okay, so it is an intersection. It is basically about PID. It is basically about PID controllers and controllers overall. And it is a very important topic, regardless of pipeline. Like, we use it everywhere. In ROS or anything you do with robotics, we use some type of controls, and PID control is most common form of control. So you might have understood what's taught earlier, you might not have understood some things that have been taught early, but still this is a kind of independent topic and an interesting one. So let's begin. Okay, so we'll be focusing more on the concept of PID rather than the code. Codes have been given, and I'll go quickly through it, but the more important things are concept. So first of all, what is a control? Okay, we are studying about robot control. What is a control? Control basically is a simple system which gives command to your robot that how will it learn. You can imagine almost like it's a like CPU. Okay, you provide it with some input. It will process that input and give commands to the bot that how the bot would move. It's as simple as that. Any bot you move, you have to use some control system, because the control system will give commands to bots to move. Okay, so there are two types of control system: open loop control system and closed loop control system. Okay, open loop control system, as name suggests, is basically that the control system which does not know the state of the robot. Okay, what do you mean by not knowing state of the robot? That it does not, you can say that it does not take constant inputs. Okay, it knows the initial state of the robot and nothing else. Okay, an example of simple open loop control is washing machine. Okay, a washing machine, you set a timer for 10 minutes and it would wash clothes for 10 minutes. It does not know after 10 minutes or after 5 minutes whether the clothes have been washed or clothes have not been washed. Okay, so it is just following a simple instruction. It does not have the state of the clothes. And control loop, whereas, has the state of the system at each point. Okay, you can say that it takes constant inputs about the system, and it acts on that information. It acts accordingly. Okay, an example you could say is like automatic light. Okay, an automatic light on streets. Okay, when the car passes, then it starts. It switches on. When the car goes, it switches off. Whereas a normal light are closed open loop control. Once you press the switch, it will be open. The lights would be on and it would be off at the last step. It does not know whether there is a car in front of it or does not. So in real life, we use control loops. Okay, we use control loop control systems. Okay, because we use this system because in real life there are many variables, many very complex system real life. So we have to use this type of system. This type of systems we have to use. Okay, so now we move to PID controller. Okay, PID controller is acronym as written for proportional, integrative, integral, and derivative. Okay, it is one of the most popular closed loop controller. It is one of the most popular closed loop controller, and most of the things of closed loop controller control is done using PID controller, and it is used in a huge spectrum of things, from automatic and self-driving cars to quadcopters. It is used everywhere. Okay, and as I said, I think there's a typo. This should be control loop. This should be closed loop. So we use closed loop everywhere in real life because there are a lot of variables. It's a very complex system. Just giving the initial state, we can't derive the things. Okay, so now moving to PID. We will come back to this video. Now we move to PID control. Okay, so as written, PID has three names. Okay, proportional, integral, and derivative. So based on a lump sum view is that based on these three errors, we will drive the bot. Okay, so what are these three errors? What is it is not, what is it's not? Okay, so first of all, what is an error and what is the proportional error? The simple error. Okay, so error is simply a term which gives you the difference between desired state and control state, and based on that error basically acts as an input for the system, and based on that system will act upon. So first let's move to proportional error, the simplest one. Okay, what is a proportional error? Okay, so simply, first of all, what is an error? Error is current state minus desired state. Okay, from here on we'll take an example of a quadcopter. Okay, so let's see that, say that we have a quadcopter, a modern one, a very high-tech quadcopters. Okay, we want is to, with the desired state, we want is it to reach height is equals to 10 meter. Okay, so the desired state as written here is the h is equals to 10. Okay, so now we'll calculate the simple error. Okay, what is EP? So first let it say it is at height is equals to 1, then its height is equals to 3, and height is equals to 3. We take these three states, okay, and we'll calculate EP. So I will request you to calculate EP. It's very simple, okay. What will be EP for state 1, state 2, state 3? You calculate on your paper, someone can write it in chat. I'll just see the chat. Yeah. Someone can write the answers. It's pretty simple. Like, and if someone has a question also, they can ask. Okay. I have explained you open loop controller, closed loop controller, and what controllers are. We are moving in PIMD. Okay. So, okay. You might not have understood what I was telling. I'll just show you and we will move forward. Next time I think you might understand. Okay, so yeah, see, what is it? Pretty simple. Like, what error is? Error is current state minus desired state. When we come to state 1, the current state is h is equals to 1, the desired state is equals to h is equals to 10. 1 minus 10 minus 10. State 2, 2 minus 10 minus 6. State 3, 3 minus 10 minus 7. So these are just three error values. Okay, this is the error value at state 1, error value at state 2, error value at state 3. Okay. And what we do in proportional error, we just multiply it with a proportionality constant P and we have a total error. And based on this error, we'll move the bot. Okay. So you might think that how we'll move the bot or what is it, what is not. Okay. So now coming to P control. Okay. I'll tell you what. So imagine there's a quadcopter. Okay. So what we control in a quadcopter, we control the speeds of the fans in a quadcopter. We control the speeds of the fan. So we have to input the velocity at which, what is the input we are giving to the controller? We give the input that to the bot, we give input that bot, we say the bot, the speeds at which all four fans are moving. That, so the input we are giving to bot basically, or the output of the controller is just the speed, okay, speed of each fans, okay. So the controller has to decide what speed it will give to bot based on the input. So currently we are providing only P. We are using P control. The only input we provide is P error. So basically what bot will do, it will multiply P. P is multiply the error at any state E. It will multiply it with a proportionality constant, making the total error or speed P into it will. Yeah, it will P into, I'll get back to that question. It will make it P into EP. Okay, so that is the total error. And based on that error, we'll have the speed. So the speed at which each fans would move will be equal to P into EP. Okay, so basically you can understand like nets will not go into each number. So basically the concept you have to understand is that when the bot is far away, like when the bot is at state 1, the error is huge. We multiply error with a proportionality constant, so it is a big number. Okay, so the force will be bigger. Okay, so we apply big force. Okay, when we reach state 3, the error is -7, and we multiply, suppose you have proportionality constant at 1. Okay, so what is the total error at state 1? Total error is -9. What is total error at state 3? -7. So we apply, suppose -9 for Newton force at state 1. And if we are taking speed, we apply like -9 meter per second at state 1, we apply -7 meter per second at state 3. This is the concept. Okay, so the farther we have, the more force or more speed or more force speed, whatever we apply to bot, the closer we get, we apply the lower speed. Okay, and when we reach at the state like h is equals to 10, the error basically is equals to 0. 10 minus 10 is equals to 0. So the force or speed, speed of the wings basically turns to 0. So this is the concept. Like the farther we have, the more force we apply. At the center, we apply when it reaches, we apply no force. It's zero. So basically, based on this concept, we see that it will reach the center very fast. Okay. So this is the PID P control. Now you must be thinking like it's perfect. It's perfect that when the bot reaches the center, when we report it to the center, the speed or the force we apply would be zero. So it is perfect, like we are controlling the bot perfectly. So there's no issue, like then why we need IoT control? No, it won't happen like that. Can anyone tell me in chat, like what can the issue be, okay? What issue can we face if we use only P control? Like it's on the screen only, but can someone tell in the chat, like what issue we can face? Like if, yes, it would vibrate, or a better word will be, it would oscillate, okay? Oscillate around the center. See, what we are controlling is basically force we apply or the speeds of the wing. So I'm for the next session, we'll use the term force only, because the more farther the wings of the quadcopter will move, more force, the more thrust force will be generated. So basically what we are controlling is force, okay? So when it reaches the center, the force will be zero, but it's nowhere written that the velocity will be zero, okay? So when it reaches the center for first time here, so the force we apply is zero, okay, very good. But it would have some velocity, which it is gained after accelerating this much. And due to this velocity, it would go up, then it would again come down, go up, come down, go up, come down, go up, come down. So this would oscillate around the center for an infinite time, okay? That's the problem, okay? You must have read about simple harmonic motion or oscillations in your school time. So this is like that. It is almost a similar case when we use a spring and a box, okay? It oscillates around the center. So what we have to do, we have to somehow damp the system, okay? So first I'll show you this one in simulation, then we'll go to. So we have given you two codes, drone PID and don't PID with graph. Simple, in this graphs, all graph is also generated. In this only PID control, no graph is generated, okay? And going through the code, as I said, I'll just quickly go through the code, okay? So here we are importing, like this, you all know, we are importing some basic libraries. We are setting gravity, we are connecting it, and then we are spawning or loading these quadcopters and the plane. And this whole is a CV2, like CV2 for generating this box using which we will control the PID, okay? This CV2 you must have learned in Python. If you don't have learned, no problem. Like this is not related exactly to PID. This is OpenCV. We are generating a box. And now we come here. We have these three values, integral derivative, etc. from previous. And based on those values, we provide how much speed or the bot will get. And at the end, we publish the results on the results at the end we publish the results on our CMD, okay? See, based on the three inputs we apply force, okay? So this is, then when there's no new command that you don't know which is written here, it's just like we have used a lot of them together. And OpenCV, other than that, OpenCV part is just for generating the graph and that controller. If you don't, you can just copy it and that's it. So I'll request you to like go through this code again and again at your home, and like you can search bits by bits if you don't understand on net, and you have that official source also. If you still don't understand, we are there on Discord, okay? So let's run this code and see the fun, okay? So this is our quadcopter, pretty nice quadcopter. And we are taking desired state is equal to height is equal to 3. So somewhere height should be here, okay? Somewhat here. Now this is our controller. We have our controller in which we control PID. What is PID? We are controlling that proportionality constant, okay? We talked about that. The total error is equals to error at each state. This we can't control. This the computer will give it based on state, and we are controlling this P, okay? The proportionality error, like at what extent that force will be applied. Like if we take a very big value of P, it would go with huge speed. If we take a small value, it would go with small speed, okay? This basically controls just the proportionality constant, okay? So let's take any random value. Let's take that graph I showed was somewhat near 100, okay? So let's take that value and let's run it. See, it's going up. It has already crossed 3. It has already crossed 3. It has gone 3.5 and now it comes down. Okay. And then it will oscillate around here. 3 is here around. It would constantly oscillate around 3. So this is not what we want ideally. We don't want it to oscillate. Okay. This is oscillating around the 0.3. Close it and here the graph comes. Okay, see, it is oscillating around the 0.3. Okay, that's the problem. Okay, because at 0.3 the force is zero, but it still has some velocity. So if we for once let's change the value of p, have a huge value. Okay, what will change? Can anyone tell what will change if we have a bigger value of p? Anyone in chat, like, no, it won't oscillate less, even it would oscillate more. Okay, if we have a bigger value, as the speed, yeah, it's very, very correct. Its speed, its velocity increases, because velocity, we are here inputting the force, we are providing, see here in the code, we are providing the force that we apply on the board. Okay, and based on our, and what is the value of force? The value of force is proportionality constant into error. So the bigger proportionality constant we input, the more the force on the ball will be, and hence the more velocity we will see. Okay, and if there is more velocity, we'll see more oscillation. Okay, because yeah, it would go way more far, more farther. Like, see, it went way, like last time it went to 4, this time it last time it went to 10 12, this time it went to almost 41 and came back. Okay, no, or even it went to almost 4 and came back. Okay, so the more velocity we apply, the farther it would go, basically concept is, and then it will again oscillate around the center. Okay, so yeah, you would say that then take a very small value of p, it won't oscillate that much. Okay, correct, but it would take way more time for bot to reach the center point. That we not, we also want to like optimize the speed. Okay, so the what is the biggest problem, like we are currently facing with proportional error, we are facing error that there is an oscillation. Okay, it does not stop at the center. Okay, so what we'll use to tackle this, we'll use a concept name, you must have read the concept damping. Okay, it is a concept of like harmonic motion damping. We have to damp the bot. Okay, damp basically means that we have to slowly reduce the velocity, such that, what is the ideal situation? Ideal situation is that when it is at center, the velocity is zero and the force is zero. Okay, by proportional constant error, we are achieving that the force is zero. But what we are not achieving is that velocity is also zero. Yeah, it overshoots. Okay, yeah. Okay, so we are, what we are not achieving is that our velocity is not zero at the center. So for that, what we will use, we'll use derivative error. What is derivative error? Okay, so derivative error, basically it same thing. Okay, derivative error is like, okay, if you have some problems, I'll show you one thing. Okay, you don't have to like, okay, we'll come back to it. Okay, it's too much mathematics. Okay, so derivative error, okay, what is derivative error? Derivative error basically tells you what is the change, rate of change of the error. Okay, so can anyone tell me what is the rate of change of error in this case? Okay, what value tells us the rate of change of error? Can anyone tell what tells you the rate of change of error in this case? What is the rate of change of error? Like, yeah, someone said that rate of change of position. Correct. What is the name of rate of change of position? Is speed. Okay, so here the rate of change of error is speed, and what we want, zero at the required state, it is speed. We want force to be zero, we want speed to be zero. So okay, what we'll do for that, we'll use derivative error. What derivative error tells? Derivative error tells us about rate of change of error, and we multiply it similarly to a proportionality algorithm. Let's see what it is. So for like, I have done here gradient. Okay, I have done here, there's not a continuous graph. In real life, it is continuous graph, but you could imagine like infinite of these rectangles will form a continuous graph basically. So like for ease, we are doing like this. Okay, so we are directly minusing. If in the final, we'll simply use differentiation. Okay, so for state 2, what is this ED? Okay, what is ED? It is 9.5 minus 10, the last error, to minus 0.5. State 3, 8.5 minus 9.5, minus 1. State 4, 8 into minus 7, minus 0.5. Okay, so this at each state, this tells, ED tells you rate of change of error. It tells you rate of change of error, or at which rate the error is changing. So what we want ideally, that at the center, the force is zero, and also the rate of change of error is zero, so that it does, rate of change of error is also zero. So like in this case, we want that speed is also zero. So for achieving that, we'll do simply that thing. We multiply with this proportional constant P, we'll multiply the ED with a proportional constant D. Okay, so the total error is P into EP plus D into ED. Okay, this is our total error. So what this term would do, what this term is do, I cleared like what proportional term will do. Proportional term will simply increase the force based on the distance. The more farther the vortex, more force we are applying. What this term will do, this term will do that based on the rate of change. The more the rate of change, the less it would, it's coming negative, okay? Because rate of change of it is coming negative constantly. So what this negative term will do, it would decrease the total force. You can imagine this total error, we are basically equating it to total force, okay? So this term is increasing force, whereas this term is decreasing the total force, and it is decreasing the total force based on the speed. The more the speed is, more this term will decrease, more the error would be, and more the error would be, more it would decrease the force, the more negative value this would have. So what this would do, if the quadcopter is coming with like 100 meter per second, okay, near that, so it would apply, suppose, a speed of 1000, okay. If the bot is coming with 50, it would apply a negative force of 500. So 500. So based on like that only, it would decrease the force based on the speed. So this would create a damping effect, which would slowly damp the bot. Okay, this is PD control. Okay, so the graph would like, see this graph. This graph had very big peaks. Okay, whereas this graph have like small peaks, and it damps very, very quickly. Why this is still not perfect, we'll go to in eye control. But first, for like now, see that the graph has become better. Okay, I'll just run the graph and show you. So we were like, now we'll have values of P also. Let's have 100 for P, 100 for I, like lump sum 100, like does not matter a bit that much. We're just taking example. So yeah, like 135, let's go. Okay, so you'll see that the performance is better than last time. So it goes up, and it would come down quicker. Okay, see, it came down quicker, and now next it's oscillating. So it is, and it would, like, this was the last graph was like continuously the speed was not decreasing, but in this graph the speed would eventually decrease, and it would decrease like faster. Like it's not, the change is not that significant. We have to calibrate the values, but the concept is like that only. So let's see the graph that is generated by this. So see this time I increased high. We have to increase D. That's why the effect was not visible. Okay. Sorry, absolutely sorry. Yeah. Let's do this. With decreasing. See, now you see the difference. There was only PI, the difference, it went so high. In this case, it did not went do it. It went a bit up, and it's initially, it immediately came to like the value. So see, it is like way better than last time. As you can see, the graph is way better than last time. See, it went only one time, it went up and then it came down. Okay, so this, because there's a constant damping, okay, the more, as the speed is constantly being decreased by the T term, so that's what, that in last case, like we just saw the graph, like a similar graph here. Okay the graph is gone. In last case we see, okay, I'll show you the graph. Okay, one second. What's the difference? Yeah. See, this is 100 P graph. And I'll show you. And this is graph of 100 P 100 D. Okay. See the difference between two graphs. What's the difference that's being generated? So see, if we take 100 P, the graph is done by same code. I've just pre-made the graph. See, when we take 100 P only, so this goes constantly, this is, there's a natural damping, because in real life, there's air resistance, this, that. So there's some natural damping, but it's very slow, and the graph goes up, down, it goes so high, and this, okay? Because at this point, the speed is very high. But what happens when we do D, the speed is being constantly decreased. So at this point, the speed is not that high. And as soon as it goes, the D is there, as soon, and D is constantly decreasing speed, it very, very nicely comes down, and very quickly comes down to zero. And it is quite good. Okay. So you understood the concept of D, na? Like if you have any doubt, you tell me now. Then we'll go to I. Okay. Any doubt you can ask. Yeah, we add the derivative controller with the, no, matlab, controller is same only. The value we are using, the total error we are calculating. Like, see, total error was P dot EP, and here it was p.ep plus d.ed. Okay, so the value we are giving to the controller, it just changes, like the total error we are providing to the controller. So yeah, you can say that we add both values, like simply. Okay, someone has any questions? Like one, yeah, the drone was bit below, right? Yeah, that's we will discuss that. This graph is not perfect. See, there are two problems in this graph. The final point is also coming a bit lower and the peak is also quite high. So yeah, I like one we saw earlier that was like distance. This graph now, so it's a bit lower. Definitely it's a bit lower and we'll discuss why it's a bit lower. Okay, I controller we come to. Any other doubt? Okay, so if someone has doubt, I'll give you 30 seconds more. You can ask. Yeah, no doubt. Let's move forward. Okay, as you pointed out, there is some issue. There are two issues. Like it is going up, peak is also a bit high, and like it is going below the point. Okay, so what's the problem? So someone tell me that when we reach zero, okay, so when we reach the our final state, okay, height is equal to 3, the force on the board that we are applying should be zero or should be some value. Someone tell me, you understand my question? Like when we reach our state h is equal to 3, what are the forces that are being applied? We are applying zero force, okay, we are not applying any force. Is there any other force that being applied to their board at this point? Okay, at when the board is at h is equal to zero, we are using, yeah, exactly, gravity. Gravity is always being applied down. Okay, some gravitational force is always being applied downwards to the board. Okay, so when we want board to be stabilized at h is equal to 3, so for that, when the board reaches to reaches h is equal to 3, we want board to stay there for h is equal to 3 forever. Okay, so for that we have to constantly apply. Suppose for its mass is like 10 kg. Okay, so 100 newton force has been applied on it. So when the board reaches 3, 100 newton upward force should be applied to the board to balance the gravitational force. Okay, so that's the point. So what is gravity in this case? Gravity is an steady state error, okay, a steady state error, or you can say an external force that we are not applying it force, its value is constant and it is being constantly applied. Okay, so gravity, what we say, it's steady state error. Okay, and in this case it's gravity, in other cases it might be anything. Okay, it like if you'll see that in video, that in the case of a self-driving car, a rock can come in front of car and that car would go grow away from its axis by like 3 units. That then 3 units is a steady state error. Okay, so we have to solve that error. Okay, so how can we solve that error? In this case, in case of gravity, you could say that we can simply solve that error by first we'll set gravity to 0, we'll calculate the values, and that in each value we'll add just 100. Okay, so it would solve like we can solve in this case like that, but in this case we know everything, that's why we can solve, but it's not the real case. For that we'll use what is known as my audio is coming now. Okay, I think it's coming. So for that, we'll use what is known as I, okay, for resolving steady state error. Okay, they in real life also, there can be like a 1,000 things can happen to, but as I said, there's a self-driving car. Okay, you are going on path, everything is good. A rock comes. Due to the rock, the car goes away from the axis by 3 units. That 3 units are steady state error. Okay, that is constant and that is came randomly from the external environment. Okay, so for solving that, we use what is known as I. Okay, what is known as I. So yeah, so this is the slide, PID control. So what does I control do? I control just tells, I control has the, you could say in a way that I control has data from past. Okay, it has all the it has all the data from past, and using that data it tells that is there a steady state error, if there is a steady state error or there is no steady state error, and if there is a steady state error, how to nullify it. Okay, so I'll tell you, look at this graph. Okay, how we'll calculate the value of EI. Okay, so look at this graph. See, the graph is here it reaches steady state. Okay, it reaches a steady state. So in this, very interestingly, in this point, as you see, it reached steady state at 2.62. okay, the bot basically stopped at 2.62. What happened at 2.62? Interesting. What happened at 2.62? See, the speed of bot is zero because it's at a steady state. Height is not changing. So that D point is zero. So the net error is P into 0.38, the difference. So P into 0.38 is basically balancing the gravity, okay? So this is happening 2.68 because there's still some error left, like 0.38 error is left. And based on that 0.38 error, there is some P into 0.38, and that P into 0.38 is basically balancing the gravity. But we want this steady state to be achieved at 3. So we have to apply a constant force at upward. So what happens is when we use integral error, when the bot reaches the steady state, okay, we multiply, there's an integrating term, okay, we basically, like we use this term, we integrate E into dt, okay, and multiply it by the proportionality constant of integration of the PID control, EI control, okay. So what happens if the error, okay, ET is zero, okay, the error is zero, and then it is achieving the steady state, then zero integration, it would be zero, and this whole term turns out to be zero, no problem. But if the, but in this case, is the error is zero in steady state? Is the error in zero steady state? Someone tell us chat, what is the error? Okay, you tell the amount of error. What is the error in the steady state of this graph? What is the error? The final, here the value of height is. What is the error in steady state? Yeah, about 0.4, minus 0.4, okay? Yeah. You say, okay, so the error is minus 0.8. Let me see. So error basically whatever, the mode of error is zero. The error is current state minus desired state. It is minus 0.4. So the error here is minus 0.4. So based on that, if you see that using PD control, the total error we was using, see the speed is zero, as you see the steady state. So this term is zero, this is minus 0.4 into P. That is the force around what we are applying, okay? So some upward force is being applied constantly to the bot that is balancing the gravity. So what will happen when we use I controller, here this error will come, and this error, we will integrate this error, will multiply, and we will multiply it with KI, and it would generate an upward force that will take the bot upward. Okay, based on suppose like we have the error is minus 0.3 and we integrate it, and like suppose like our constant is minus 1, whatever it is, anything. So if the error is not basically in the steady state, if error is not zero, this would apply an upward force. If it is below the error line, it is, if it above the error line, it will apply a downward force. Okay, if the error is not zero, if the error is zero, suppose that the bot is achieving a steady state at 3 only, then the error is zero. And then this whole value will be zero, and hence I would not contribute. So what is I basically doing? You have to understand the concept. What is I doing? That I, if the error is not zero and the bot is achieving at steady state at a place where error is not zero, it would apply a force on the negative direction, basically nullifying that effect, and would try to achieve error, try to achieve steady state at point zero, at the state zero, at the base state, okay, where error is zero. Once the error is also zero and steady state is applied, then I is simply zero. Okay, so that's the whole concept. Okay, you understand? Now I'll show you some examples. First, you tell me, you understood what I was telling, like what I is basically doing. Don't get into values. Okay, values you can test and all. You are understanding concept first. Yeah, very good. The D term dampens, and I term removes the steady state error. Because if I term basically removes the steady state error, and if the error is not zero, I term would act if in steady state. Okay. Okay. Now, the term basically is, as I said, that I removes the steady state error. Okay. When the steady state error, a steady state is achieved. In this case, the steady state is achieved, and error here is 0.38. So error here is 0.38. So that I term would come into play and apply an upward force on the bot. That would make, okay. So now we'll use it. Okay. So I have like done some testing and like found this some values. Like let's take some good values. Like okay. So let's take it 200. We are not just using PID now. Okay. We will use all three terms now. Finally. Okay. Now let's take I to. See this values, like where do you will get this? Okay. When you apply, okay, I'll simply, so one sec, error term, when you, it's not written, ये इट सिंपली लाइक हियर इट वाज PEP plus DED, here it will be I plus EI. Okay, it would simply be PEP plus DED plus IEI. And don't take tension about plus positive and negative, like PDV control. Okay, so that positive, negative, like covered in the equation. Okay, because this PD and I we control. Okay, so yeah, this let's take values and generate a graph. I'm trying to take. Okay, this is some rough values I've taken. Let's run the graph. Okay, it's these three, and like it stopped there. Okay, now if you see, it slowly you will see that where the steady state is achieved, and what's the difference between the graphs. Like it done for this, you see the values here. Okay, the values are of the height. You can slowly adjusting to the final. Like it's almost reached there. It would reach three. Okay, basically it would reach three. See, this I term is only pushing it. Okay, if there would be no I term, like it would have stopped because speed is basically zero. Okay, and we have to balance gravity also. We'll stop it at 3.9. Basically, we have almost achieved. So see the graph here, what happens? Like this graph is almost similar to last one, just that it is not stopping at 2.7, like it stopped like some, it is stopping at 3. Okay, I'll compare all three graphs now, okay? I compare all three graphs. This is one graph, two graph. Now let's achieve the third graph. Almost we took the values. What values we took? The 51. Now, once. Yeah, we took values similar to this one. Okay, so let's keep all three graphs and compare them. So these two, now let's compare. First, let's keep this down. Let's compare these two. What's the difference? Okay. This graph is not like, okay, let me see. I'll just regenerate that. I'm not finding that 100 graph. I'll just regenerate it. Almost the same values. Let's just regenerate that. So here the graph is, and let's compare it with this graph. Okay, so what's the basic? See, this is also going up. Okay, this is not that big thing. You can cut. So this upward is not that big. What has main thing you must notice between this, that this is stopping in steady state at 3, whereas this is stopping steady state is around 2.6. Okay, here the steady state is around. So that's the big difference. Okay. So what is I doing? I is balancing the gravity, that the what is causing the steady state error. The gravity is causing that steady state error, because at the steady state at 3, we don't need force on the board to be zero. We need force on the board to be equal to the force of gravity that has been applied. So that thing is done by I control. Okay, and that I control is doing. Okay, so here the force is 3. here the steady state is achieved at 3, whereas here the steady state is achieved at 2.7, because that 0.4 minus 0.4 error that we were talking, that in that into the proportionality constant is basically balancing the gravity. Whereas as in this case, that is balanced directly by the I term. And this is not just in case of gravity, like it could be anything. We will see that in video. Okay. So yeah, that basically sums up our this. If someone has any doubt, you can ask. Okay. If someone has any doubt, you can ask. Like, was everything clear? Okay, I think everything was clear. Like next, I will show you. Yeah, very good, very good. I'll show you a video, okay, 6 minutes video that would clear any remaining doubt you have. Like I took the example of a quadcopter. This takes an example of a self-driving car. Okay, you might relate more with this also. Okay, wait, I have not shared audio. Obviously, I will just share. Okay, one sec. Share audio. Yeah, how do we apply this concept? Yeah, you will see the application of this concept in like control car.
Let's take a deeper look at this in a lab setting.
So yeah, is the audio of the video coming?
Yes.
Yeah, one second. I'll read the video at 1.6.
The technology being developed for driverless vehicles is pretty incredible. In the near future, there will be robotic cars traveling on normal roads with the safety and efficiency of the best human drivers. These autonomous vehicles use various sensors to be able to localize themselves in any environment. They are also then able to construct a detailed plan to get from their current location to any desired destination. This video will provide an introduction to how these autonomous vehicles are then able to follow their desired trajectories. Getting a vehicle to follow a trajectory may seem simple to those who have driven before, but is it? Let's take a deeper look at this in a lab setting. If we want to follow a line, but we are too far to the left, we turn to the right, and vice versa. But how much do we turn? If the steering wheel is turned a fixed amount to the left or to the right, the approach is called bang-bang control. For controlling a car, this doesn't actually work that well. The response is very jerky and uncomfortable for the passengers. Fortunately, we don't have to steer like this in a car, since there is a range of angles the steering wheel can take. One way to set the steering wheel angle is to use what is called proportional control. Rather than turn the wheel a fixed amount, proportional control steers harder the further away we are from the desired trajectory. We take a measurement called the cross-track error to define how far away from the desired trajectory the vehicle is. Therefore, the steering angle we use is this cross-track error multiplied by a scaling factor called the proportional gain. The range of values the proportional gain can take drastically alters the performance of the vehicle. As you can see from this overlay, the performance gets better as the gain increases, but at a cost. If you start too far away from the desired trajectory with a high gain, the system can spin out of control. With the best gains, proportional control returns better results than bang-bang control, but it still doesn't work that well. With proportional control, the car can be crooked when it reaches the center line. The result of this is that the controller will repeatedly overshoot the actual desired trajectory and not actually follow it. To correct this overshooting problem, we need to consider additional error measurements and use them to update our steering command. A good candidate for an extra measurement is to look at the cross-track error rate, or in other words, how fast we are moving in a perpendicular direction with respect to the desired trajectory. If we are perfectly following the trajectory, our cross-track error rate will be zero. In control theory, this is what is called a derivative term. This rate term can then be multiplied by its own gain and added to the proportional term to construct an updated controller. Now that we have two terms, we have two gains that must be tuned simultaneously. Conceptually, we can think that increasing the proportional gain will increase the pull that the vehicle feels towards the desired trajectory. Increasing the derivative gain increases the resistance the car will feel against moving too quickly towards the line. Fixing the proportional gain, if the derivative gain is too low, the system will be what is called underdamped and it will still oscillate. If the derivative gain is too high, the system will be what is called overdamped and will take a long time to correct for offsets. Properly choosing the derivative gain allows the car to approach the desired trajectory quickly with a cross-track error rate close to zero. This is called being critically damped. Despite the success so far, for a complete controller, we're not done yet. Environmental factors or mechanical defects can change the vehicle's nominal behavior and thus the performance of the controller. For example, if there is a heavy crosswind, the vehicle will drift unless the driver counteracts this wind force with a corrective steering command. Here is an example we can easily demonstrate. Imagine our vehicle is driving along and hits a pile of rocks, which knocks its front end out of alignment, and therefore a zero steering command no longer keeps the vehicle driving straight. As you can see, with the controller that has been described so far, the vehicle experiences a buildup of a lane offset, or steady state error. One way to address this problem is to add yet another term called an integral term. This third measurement sums up the cross-track error to give an indication if we are spending more time on one side of the trajectory or the other. You can see that if we sum up the cross-track errors, we obviously spend more time on one side of the trajectory. The integral term we propose is then exactly this sum multiplied by a gain. Now, three gains will need to be tuned all at once, which can be quite difficult to do by hand. If the gain is too large, the controller can go unstable, because normal controller fluctuations will be exaggerated. If the gain is too small, it can take too long to respond to these dynamic changes. When the gain is just right, the controller will be able to quickly correct for the front-end misalignment and return to its nominal performance. The combination of these three terms is then what is referred to in control theory as PID control. Okay. Let's take a deeper look at
So that was like the video. You saw it, the application. You saw the application of PID in like you saw the application of PID in like self-driving car. The more would be covered by Sanidhya, my partner, okay, in self-driving car and sector. And so I'll sum it up. Okay, so in the video you saw that the PID car, in the video you saw that what was the value we were controlling in the quadcopter, that was force. In this, we were controlling the steering angle, okay? And based on that, we used PID controls, okay? So, and a detailed code and all also will give in the Sanidhya. Now, I'll just sum up the things, okay? So, proportional constraint, yeah. First, let's see the mathematical forms, okay? So, see, this is simple. Kp into Et, the proportionality constant into the error that we discussed only. This is like Kd into Ded by Dt, okay? So, that there we were Ed, we are, if the graph is continuous, in real life, the graph are continuous. So we directly use in real life the graphs are continuous. So we can't just minus them. So the difference, the rate is known by the differentiation. Okay. So dET by dt. Okay. And this, the integration term is ki into et dt. Okay. This I will explain 1 minute more. Like what this is doing. Okay. As told in the video. Okay. It is, see, if you are spending more time on one side of track, this would give the value, it would tell you to go to the opposite side. Like in this case, 2.6, it stopped. Okay. So if we take the error, if we take the integration, the net integration would come negative because the more side of the things happened, this side of the error is negative for the large amount of time. Okay. So the net error would be negative. So for to correct that, it would apply an upward force. Suppose the gravity was on upper side, okay, and this would have the graph would, okay, I might just, oh, no, it would keep more, the gravity would have been above side, okay, and the steady state error would be coming like the like final state instead of 2.6 would come like 3.4. So the net error would be 0.4, and the more time you spend above, the for more time the error would be positive. So the integration of error for more time would be positive, okay? And the hence to correct it, it will apply a negative force. So that's the thing, okay? So the I controller basically detects the which side the steady state error is coming by integrating. Whichever side the steady state error is coming, the integration would, net integration would come that side. And based on that, we can, like I controller can be summed up. Okay, so this is closer look, proportional, integral, derivative. Based on these three, proportional is like simply, we are telling the farther you are, more force you apply when you are fast, less force you apply when you are close. The issue of oscillation is solved by derivatives. And if there is a steady state error, like gravity, or if you come up with a pile of log and there's a net you deviate from the part, like in that car example also, you saw that you deviate net from the central part, you deviate by a certain amount net from the part, okay? That certain amount is known, that certain amount comes up to the steady state error, okay? So that is solved by integral command. And at the final, like this are some additional contents you can check out. These are some additional contents you can definitely check out, like one by one you can say. And this link of this slide is also given in that GitHub code, and you try, like you might search, more examples would be given by my partner Sanidhya, and then you can try it on different things also. And the code, as I said, you need not to understand the whole code, you go part by part and try to understand the code. Thank you, it was wonderful teaching you. If you have some doubts, 5 minutes I will take some doubts, okay? For 5 minutes I might, yeah, okay, so we are running out of time. Okay, so okay, if there's some doubt, my partner Sanidhya would take the doubts. Okay, thank you for the session. Bye.
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes.
Okay, Harsh, you may stop sharing. I will share.
Yeah, 1 second.
Yeah, I will be explaining you the coding part shortly. Okay, is my screen visible?
Yes, it is.
Good evening, everyone. Myself, Sanidhya Tapadia from Robotics Club, IIT BHU. And now I will be explaining you the coding part of PIT. And we will be taking an example of line following car. So let me first show you the simulation which we will be implementing. So basically, our motive is that. Just a second. Yeah. So our motive is that we have to make the car follow the line y equals to 0, this car, to this line y equals to 0. And for this, we will be adjusting the P, I, and D values. So these are the P, I, and D values. We can adjust these using the track bar. I will be explaining you how to make this track bar and how to optimize these values, P, I, and D. So this is the simulation. As you can see, the car is trying to follow the line y equals to 0. Okay, so now let's move on to the code. So basically the code contains three parts: the move car function, the calculate error function, and the while loop. So in move car function, we will be moving the car using differential drive method. So let me give you a brief about differential drive method. So let's suppose that we have to make the car move left. Then we will be giving the car the right wheel more torque than the left wheel, so that an external left torque acts on the car and the car moves left. Similarly, for moving the car rightwards, we will be giving the left wheel more torque than the right wheel, so that an external rightwards torque act. So I will be explaining you this in more detail in the code. Now comes the calculate error function. Here we will be calculating error using PID control, and it returns an action which we will be feeding in the move car function so that we can move the car. And the third part is while loop, where all the functions will be called and the track bar will be called also. So okay, now let me take you to my VS Code screen. Okay, so here is the code. So firstly, I have imported all the libraries we will be needing. So here I have loaded the simulation using p.connect, and I have set it the gravity. Here I have loaded the plane using p.load urdf, and these are the car positions that we will be needing. So basically the car is spawned at 0.3 and 0.1. Okay, so this m equals to 0 is the slope of the line. As you know that y equals to 0, if we compare it with y equals mx plus c, then m is 0 and c is 0. So by using m, we get angle equals tan inverse m equals to 0, and we will be loading the car at angle 0 and at y equals to 0. So now comes this print line function. This basically prints the line which we will be using like that black line for visual only. So for this, I have used this line.urdf. You may find it here. So this is nothing but a box of 2000 cross 0.1 cross 0.01. So 0.1 and 0.01 are just used to shorten the width and height of the line. And this 2000 basically indicates the length of the line. So you may also use like p.add user debug line function for printing the line, but here I have used p.load urdf. Okay, now comes p.get joint info functions for so using this function, we find that the index of front left wheel is 2, the index of front right wheel is 3, and the index of back left wheel and back right wheel are 4 and 5 respectively. So here I have given the velocities to all the wheels initially 0. So the purpose of this is like I will be using torque control to move the wheels. So I have made the velocities initially 0 so that like we will be so that there is no confusion, like we will be using only torque control and not the velocity control. Okay, so now here I have created the track bar. I am sure you must have studied this in the OpenCV workshop. So let me give you just a brief. So using create track bar function, we have created three track bars for P, I, and D having range from 0 to 500. Here I am getting the values of P, I, and D using get track bar position function. Now here you must note that I have used P equals get track bar position divided by 10. So I have done this because I will be needing only values from 0 to 50 for P. That's why I divided it by 10. Similarly for I will be needing values only from 0 to 0.05. That's why I have divided by 10,000. And for D, I will be needing values from, sorry, it should be 10. I will be needing values from 0 to 5,000. That's why I have multiplied it by 10. Here is the cv2.waitkey1 and 0xff function. So this is just needed to keep the track bars active in real time. So for more info, you can read this comment also. Oh, okay, so now our desired state is 0, as we have to make the line follow the line y equals to 0. And here is our base torque equals 10. I will be using this base torque in this move car function. So as you can see, this basically takes two arguments, the base torque and the action. So the action we will be calculating using this calculate error function. I will be explaining you this calculate error function later. First, let me explain you the move car function. So basically we will be using torque control, as I said, and that's why we made the velocities zero initially. So as you can see, I have given the left wheel's torque equals base torque plus action, and right wheel's torque equals base torque minus action. So I have done this like if the action is positive, then the base then the left torque will be greater than the right torque. So an external rightwards torque will act on the car, and the car will be moving rightwards. Similarly, if the action is negative, then the base then the left torque will be less than the right torque, and the car will be moving leftwards. So this is basically the differential drive method. Like we will be giving different values to left and right wheels in order to move the car leftwards or rightwards. So here I've just used the set joint motor control function to give the car's torque. So now let's go into calculate error function. So in this, basically I have used three variables, integral, derivative, and previous error. So let me give you, let me explain you this function. So firstly, I have taken the value of P using get track bar position function, and I have divided it by 10. I have explained you like we will be needing only 0 to 50 value. That's why I divided by 10. Similarly for I have divided it by 10,000, and for D, I have multiplied it by 10. And this cv2.waitkey1 function is just needed to keep track bars alive. Now comes this we will be needing the y coordinate. So first I call the p.get base position and orientation function. So you must be knowing that this basically returns two arrays, the position array and the orientation array. So we will be needing only the position array, and the position array itself contains three variables, the x coordinate, y coordinate, and the z coordinate. So for y coordinate, I have given 1 here. For x or z, you may try 0 and 2. But here we will be needing only y coordinate. So now I have calculated the error by using state minus 0. So 0 is basically our desired state, and state is our current state, which we will be getting each time. So now I have calculated derivative using derivative equals error minus previous error. So you must understand that I have not given derivative equals d by dt of error. So why I have done this is we will be calling the simulation at regular intervals, and the time difference will be constant. So like if we even give derivative equals error minus previous error by delta t, then if we multiply it by d, the derivative constant, then d by delta t, we can consider it as another constant. That's why I have just given delta t equals 1 only. Like it will not have any effect on our calculations. So I am sure you must be understanding this. Now I have again updated this previous error as error, so that in the next iteration, our previous error is the new error. Now I have calculated the integral by summing up all the steady state error. So steady state error means like when the error is too small, and like the P and D controls can't optimize that error. So that's why I have kept the error like too small, 0.1 and minus 0.1. Like you may try 0.05 or 0.2 also. These are just approximate values to sum up the steady state error, integral plus equals error. And now I have calculated the PID using the formula which Harsh explained, like P into error plus D into the derivative and plus I into the integral. And by using this PID, we return an action, and this action is later fed into this move car function so that we can give the torque to the left and right wheels. Okay, so now comes the while true loop. So here firstly I have used the get keyboard events function. So this basically returns a unique key for every key we press on the keyboard. So this I have used, like I have used keyboard.get p.b3g return equal to 1. So this expression basically means that if I press enter, then execute this if loop. So firstly, if I press enter, then it will reset the simulation, then set the gravity again to -10, then load the plane using p.load urdf, and then load the car using p.load urdf. I have explained this already. So now I am again setting the velocities of all the wheels to 0, because we will be using only the torque control, as I have explained earlier. Now I am printing the line that y equals to 0 using that p.load urdf. You may try p.add user debug line function also. So in this while loop, there is another while loop which we will be calling repetitively. So let me explain this while loop also. So here I have just used the reset debug visualizer camera. So this is nothing but this will keep the camera on the car always, like we will be focusing only on the car and not around the plane. So that's why I have used this function. Now this is the p.step simulation function. So this will just step the simulation by 0.01 seconds approximately. Now I have used the get base position and orientation function. So basically this returns two arrays, position and orientation. And here I am needing the x coordinate. That's why I have used position 0 and not 1. So, for 1, we will be getting the y coordinate, which we used earlier here. You can see here. Okay, so here I am just calculating the action using calculate error function and then further feeding it into the move car function. This 10 is just the base torque which we had declared earlier as global variable here. Okay, so this basically calls the move car function. Then I have just given the time slip of around 1 by 240 seconds and I am printing the values of action and x position. So the in this way the loop will run. And now I'm saying, like, I will again get the keyboard events using get keyboard events function. And now I will again say that if I again press the enter button, then the simulation will be again resetted, and again this while loop will run. All the calculations will be done again. Again our action will be calculated and our move car function will execute, and the car will again try to follow the line y equals to 0. So this was all about the code. So do let me know if you are having some questions. Okay, I'm giving 30 seconds for questions. Okay, so there are no questions, I hope. So let me move further. So this was all about code. Now let me give you some brief about, like, what other simulations you may try in PyBullet. Like, this is the end of the workshop, but there are some cool simulations that we had tried earlier, and I will be trying to give you some more intuition about them. So this was the simulation which I had made. So let me first give you just a brief about what this function is basically doing. So basically in this bot is trying to first go to one first pink block, then it will uncover this plate and will find whether this plate contains the square or the circle. So if this contains, suppose it contains a square, then it will try to go to the blue block and that contains a square. Then it will again try to move to the pink block and again uncover its plate, and it will be circle because first one is a square. then it will again try to move to the blue block which contains circle. So this bot basically will be trying to do this all functions in the minimum time possible and using the minimum steps. So you may do this by using path planning and OpenCV. So let me play the simulation. Okay, seems like just a second. So let me play the simulation. So as you can see, the bot is first trying to go to the pink block. Now it will uncover the plates. So this comes to be a circle. So now it will try to move to the blue block with circle. Okay, so now it reached the circle one. Now it will again go to the second pink block. So now it comes to be square. So it will move to the blue block which contains a square. So you may also try this simulation using path planning and like there are algos for minimum time and for minimum steps. You may try these algos also. I have attached links to practice these. So here is the another simulation. This is the self-balancing bot. So this basically balances it upright. So however large the torque we give to this bot, it will try to stand upright. So here I have used the LQR algorithm. So let me tell you the LQR algorithm. Like it is, I have attached the links for LQR algorithms also on the later slides. So it is a similar to PID algorithm, but it is a more robust algorithm for controlling the robots. So you may try to learn that. I have attached the links also. So here I am continuously giving it torque, but it will remain upright always. You can see like it moves forward, but it will not fall. So this was all about the workshop. So here I have attached the links for LQR control. You may try these. Like these are the video series by MATLAB and this is the control bootcamp. You may try this also. And these are the links for robot learning. Like you, this is basically a different branch of robotics. I have attached links by David Silver and links to learn neural networks. And this is the link for OpenAI Gym. It is just basically a library to learn robot learning. You may try to explore these also. So this was all about the workshop. So we will be giving you a task that will be, we will be updating in Discord. And like it will be similar to the task discussed earlier. So here is the feedback form. You may try to scan it and give us some feedback. I will be giving 30 seconds for this. Okay, so this was all about the workshop. Thank you. Let me know if you are having some doubts.
If anyone doesn't have any doubt, can we have a quick picture before we end?
Yes, sir.
Can you all please turn on your videos?